With proposed tax reforms that would increase ordinary income tax rates and capital gains rates, it can be appealing to explore installment sale treatment to defer gains. However, reducing risk of repayment through the use of an intermediary can increase the risk of IRS attention when it comes to an installment sale. I'm Griffin Bridgers, and this is 10 Minutes with Griffin. For today's episode 238, we're going to just barely scratch the surface of some of the rules regarding installment sales to related parties. We're going to explore how those might be analyzed in the context of preserving installment sale deferral of gain recognition. Now, as always, this presentation is not intended to substitute for legal or tax advice and is provided for educational purposes only. A little bit about me. I do what I do because I enjoy speaking and teaching. So if you enjoy this presentation or my other materials, I'm happy to be a speaker for your upcoming event or for any in-house events you may have for your organization or firm. So if you'd like to use me as a speaker, you can email me at griffin.bridgers@gmail.com. And if you'd like to receive this and other more exclusive content, you can subscribe to my newsletter at griffinbridgers.substack.com. Now on to the presentation. Now, I've talked about installment sales in a number of my prior episodes, but the general premise is that when you sell property and receive payments in installments, then any installment received in a later year will defer recognition of a proportionate amount of gain plus interest to the time when that installment is actually received. So, if you're deferring gain recognition, what that means is that you're going to defer the capital gains tax on that gain recognition over a period of years, potentially. Now, typically, this requires you to be willing to sell property to an unrelated third party and then carry a note, in the form of a promissory note where the buying party promises to pay you back in installments over time. And there's an economic cost now because you have to rely on the creditworthiness of that third-party buyer and potentially seek security for the repayment of installments, which may not make you whole if those installments are ultimately not paid down the road if, for example, the buyer becomes insolvent. So it's better economically, ignoring the tax effects, to just take the money and run if you have a willing buyer willing to pay up front. But that requires you to pay tax on the entire purchase price when received. So, can you combine the best of two worlds? Can you reduce this risk of repayment while also creating this tax deferral on your own? And that's where the related party rules come into play. Because what Code Section 453E considers are related parties who, in essence, act as an intermediary between the original owner and the intended buyer. So, we're going to look at Code Section 453E and the related party rules, but also look at how even if you meet all of these requirements, based on their, form as set forth in the Internal Revenue Code, you're not necessarily going to have a safe harbor. There are still ways that this can go off the rails. So, jumping back to the related party rules, to understand them, you have to look in the context of two dispositions. In the first disposition, you have a sale by the original owner to a related party. That related party is intended to be an intermediary of sorts. And then you have a second disposition, which is a sale by the related party to a third party who may or may not have been a previously identified intended buyer. Now, if they're intended as an ultimate buyer from the beginning, that may be a bad fact in the grand scheme of things, and we'll talk about that in a few minutes. But to get installment sale treatment, at a minimum, what has to happen is that at least 2 years must pass between the first disposition and the second disposition. Now, there are some exceptions to that, such as a death of the original owner or corporate liquidation. And it's also important to note that you can also have a disposition within 2 years of the first disposition if you can show the IRS that tax avoidance was not a principal purpose of either the first or second disposition. Now, that's a little bit more difficult to arrive at. But otherwise, if less than 2 years separates these two dispositions, first and second, what's going to happen is that all deferred gain is going to be accelerated when that second disposition takes place. But if you get beyond the two-year period here, then you can still potentially maybe have installments that are paid after that second disposition that relate back to the first disposition that defer gain. So in that case, you'd have the related party paying installments back to the original owner from the first disposition, but then being able to take all the money and running on the second disposition. And with the benefit of having a stepped up purchase cost basis as a result of the first disposition, which reduces or eliminates any income tax that the related party would pay on the second disposition. Now that sounds all good and all fine and everything like that, but first off, you have to recognize how broad these related party rules are. They're set forth in a variety of code sections, 267B, 318, and 1239 under the installment sale rules. And we're not going to dive into these in the permutations. It's important to note that a lot of the types of intermediaries you might use, especially entities, might include things like a trustee and any other party to a trust, like a settlor or beneficiary. It could include a partnership and a partner, a corporation and a shareholder. And it could include family members as well. And it's important to note that there could be levels of attribution among these groups. So if, for example, you had somebody who was a partner of a partnership, that means that partner and the partnership are related parties. Well, guess what? You can also attribute that partnership interest from a family member to another family member. So the non-partner family member and the partnership could be treated as related parties through two levels of the application of these rules. So, what we're looking at here is not necessarily unpacking all of these permutations. It's really just important to know them at a surface level, and even to note that doing this perfectly and having a related party could be ignored ultimately when it comes to the installment sale treatment. Because, like any IRS type of analysis, they can always say, look, you've complied with the Internal Revenue Code, but even though you've complied with the letter of the law, there's a variety of ways we can attack this because this isn't the type of transaction that you would do for any reason other than tax avoidance. So, even where you comply with the form of Code Section 453E, it's important to look at what level of actual control does the original owner have over the related party after the first disposition. Because if the IRS can show that the original owner is, in essence, the same as the related party due to control issues, then the IRS can argue that the related party is, in essence, a sham and doesn't even exist. So, in that case, there is no related party. There's no first and second disposition because the IRS can collapse the two, because the first disposition would essentially just be a sale from the original owner to the original owner if the original owner is in control of that related party. So, often when you see this pop up, it's in the context of something like a trust. So, for example, it's a good idea to have an independent trustee of a trust that's going to serve as that related party or that intermediary and be able to show that the original owner did not or could not control that trustee. And even then, just showing that is just your basic ticket to entry to allow that two-year safe harbor to run under Code Section 453E. Because if the original owner is a grantor or beneficiary of that trust, or even a family member of the grantor or beneficiary of that trust, the independent trustee would still be a related party under Code Section 453E. We haven't even gotten into who's creating the trust, who is the beneficiary. Like I said, there's all sorts of permutations under that that can apply. So even if you meet the related party rules, it's important to note that you can have sham party issues that pop up, and these rules are not going to be found in any code section. These are contained in a number of cases which the IRS has argued in the past in front of the tax court and in front of a variety of federal districts in terms of whether and to what level that installment sale treatment can apply when there's a sale to a related party or what the IRS deems to be a sham party. So with that being said, my key takeaway first, and I'm not going to put this in writing, I'd say be wary where a party tries to pitch an installment sale plan which involves a related party. And that part I do have in writing here. But what I want to say is that there's a lot of people out there who are really kind of bad actors in this space. They're promoting this strategy. They may not have your best interests in mind. This is really an underhanded way to sell a product. And I know I'm going to get hate from all those people, or they're going to be trying to reach out to me to get me to lend legitimacy to their transactions. I've had both happen. But either way, all I'm saying is, allow your intuition and your spidey senses to tingle here. If you have somebody who's pushing this hard, you need to get a second opinion. That's all I'm saying here. And I'm not saying that the transaction itself doesn't work. I'm just saying you need to have somebody who doesn't have a conflict of interest or an economic interest in making it work other than just serving your general interests. Now, beyond that, it's also important to note that this does not avoid gift and estate tax issues. For example, if the sale price on the first disposition is less than the fair market value of the property, the IRS could assert gift tax on the difference in sale price between the fair market value and the actual sale price on that first disposition. And also, any payments that you're supposed to receive back from the related party that are uncollected at death are still subject to estate tax. Now, there's different things you can do, like self-canceling installment notes, to avoid that and maybe mitigate that risk, but I want to note that if you don't go that route, then any outstanding payments that are due at death could be accelerated for income tax purposes as income in respect of a decedent, which means there's no step-up in basis which would wipe out the deferred gain on those payments. So the difference is if you'd held on to that sold property until death, you could have gotten a step-up in basis. But once you convert it to a promissory note, you're no longer eligible for that step up in basis. Now, it seems like there could be a double tax there if there's the estate tax as well, but there is a deduction that the recipient of those payments can receive for estate tax that's attributable to those payments, and the calculation of that deduction is pretty taxpayer friendly under Code Section 691C. So big picture, I'd say if you're looking at an installment sale, there's ways to make it work. There's a lot of ways you can goof it up. But really what I want to say is be wary if you're dealing with somebody who's really pitching this hard as a transaction, and follow the money and ask, what other incentive do they have to be pushing this? As always, if you have questions or topic suggestions, you can email those to me at griffin.bridgers@gmail.com. Please note that I cannot give tax or legal advice in response to your questions. And if you're a promoter of installment sales, I'm not going to lend legitimacy to your strategy. Thank you again for listening to this episode of 10 Minutes with Griffin, and I look forward to seeing you in the next one.